What's good, y'all? It's your boy DJ TMac. Thank you so much for checking out this conversation. Today, I speak with Khrysis, legendary hip-hop producer representing Jamla Records and the Soul Council production team. Khrysis has worked with many legends such as Master Ace, Sean Price, Talib Kweli, Rhapsody, Busta Rhymes, De La Soul, Phife Dog, Mac Miller, and many, many more legends. I got a chance to catch up with him in Colorado Springs while he was on the Don and I tour. In this conversation, we talk the hour of Khrysis, beat critiques, working with some of those legends, and many, many more things. Unfortunately, there is no video to go along with this conversation, but it is a great one just the same. I really appreciate him taking the time and doing this. Gave us a lot of great insight, and it was a lot of fun. Be sure to follow, connect, listen, support Khrysis below. All the links are right down there, so be sure to do that and enjoy the conversation. What's good, y'all? DJ TMac here for another great hip-hop conversation. We had some producers on the show, but this one has done by far the most amount of work. I'm just calling him a legend, and it's an honor to be sitting here with him. I really appreciate his time. We got Khrysis in the building, y'all.
I ain't never gonna change. Pumping up the volume till it blow out your brain. Got your people asking, is the boy insane? I don't give a fuck, I tell them crazy deranged. Ask me what I'm doing, it's the same old thing. Banging out the jams, nasty than a glass of Tang. Banging out the jams, nasty than a glass of Tang. Banging out them jams, nasty than a glass of Tang.
Khrysis, how are you?
Peace, peace, man. Yo, T, thanks for having me, man. Yo, I'm feeling blessed, man. I love life, man. Life is great, ain't it?
It is, bro. All right, bro. The Don and I tour. Second
man.
City.
Yes, sir.
It's How's it feel, city, man? Two shows down.
Yeah, two shows down, man. It feels good, man. It feels great, man. I'm just, I'm enjoying my time, man. Having a good time, man. Rocking these records, man.
Spitting records, man. What don't you do?
I would say sing, but that would be a lie.
Can we get a little something right now?
Nah.
Okay. That's for the next one. We'll save it for the next one.
It's a lot of stuff I save for the next album. So and it was done by design.
Okay. You know what I'm saying? So, okay. Yeah. Speaking of, we got the album. I got the colored vinyl. Fire. Yeah. Make sure you guys connect with Khrysis. You got the Hour of Khrysis?
The Hour of Khrysis. It's the instrumentals actually just came out.
The instrumental vinyl
yesterday.
Yep.
No. The instrumental just came out on DSPs yesterday, and then the vinyls also came out yesterday through Fat Beats. So
was that planned to drop with the tour? I mean, obviously you're like posting the and tour doing wasn't shit for the planned, tour, but how did that?
The tour part wasn't planned, but what I did do, I did have a plan on. I did plan on okay. Whenever the vinyl drops, that's when I wanted to drop the instrumentals. It just so happened that it was right on the 1 year anniversary for my album. You know what I'm saying? So you know, because you know, I want to say last year it just took a while for vinyl. You know, vinyl take a while. And I just
ordered
took
a lot, man.
I waited
for a long time. Yeah,
this is my first vinyl, so I just learned everything. I just really took my album, used it as my baby, and took it to use everything I needed, you know, to learn on the business end of it, or everything I felt like I needed to learn on the business end of it. You know what I'm saying? So, with that said, you know, I've learned a lot within the past year, and you know, to the point, and you know, I hate to say it, man, like I took so much time trying to figure out the business end of it and how everything works that it did kind of slow my beats down a little bit.
It slows down the creative process.
Yeah, it slowed down the creative process a little bit, but you know, it's just like everything else. There's a balance to everything, so you know, right now, I guess my challenge for right now is learning how to balance. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, mastering a craft is one thing, but being able to balance it with other crafts, you know, it's not bad. You know what I'm saying? I got to be a master at least one, because if you know what I'm saying, if you're too much of a jack of all trades, you know what I'm saying, you'll never, you know what I'm saying, like,
you're not going to get to your peak in that one.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So my thing is like, master one and then figure out the rest. You know what I'm saying? So.
So was it production that you started with that you say you mastered? Was that your craft? I mean, do you cook too that like you're a master at?
I would consider my craft, like learning what I learned, I would consider my craft producing and beat making. And then after that came mixing, but then that ended up helping me with my craft as far as like, because there's a lot of, when I learned how to mix, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, I guess I spent a lot of time recording and mixing projects, especially during the Justice League days. So, you know, the Justice League era, that's when I spent a lot of time. That forced, the Justice League era forced me to have to learn how to mix my own records. And, you know what I'm saying? And that transferred, that journey transferred into the Jamla era. And, you know, to the point where it's like, all right, my mixing stuff is transferring onto the beat stuff and vice versa. So, you know, nerd shit, but you know,
no, it's,
yeah, you know,
it's
what I'm
not
saying?
That, so, that's what this channel is all about. I love digging into the details, letting people explain, because especially like a lot of these independent artists, they don't have an outlet to do that a lot of the times, I feel like. So I'm more than happy to fucking let people talk for 2 hours about a song if you want, you know what I mean?
I get what you're coming from, you know what I'm saying? So it's just a lot, you know what I'm saying? It's a lot to talk about. And I'm, you know, you came with your homework, so I'm pretty sure.
So we're going to start off with beat critiques.
Okay.
It's the beat critiques, beat critiques, beat critiques.
From the soul, y'all.
I'm having fun watching that, man. I get out of work at like 9 o'clock over here. So that's 11 when you start them usually on Instagram, right?
Okay. Yeah, it's 11 on Eastern, so it's what, 11, 10, 9 here?
It's 9 o'clock here, so okay. I get out of work.
That's perfect.
Pop it on, you know, get good vibes for the ride home. How did that start? Is that something new that just started, or were you doing that earlier in COVID also?
It started off as something that's I was doing sporadically. Real talk, it started during Ustream days. Like, I did it probably once or twice during the Ustream days. And then, like, I want to say I did it, like, I did it the first time I did it. The first time I did it for Instagram is when I made the jingle. So, yeah. So I had the jingle laying around. I think I did it, like, twice after that. And then, you know, I got asked about it a lot. You know what I'm saying?
When you going to do it? Hey,
when you going to do another beat critique? When you going to do another beat critique? When you going to do the beat critique? And then, you know, I wasn't exactly the most comfortable. The idea of doing it wasn't exactly the most comfortable for me. I'm going to be honest. You know, because I got to tell, you know what I'm saying? Because I really got to tell people what I'm thinking about their beats.
And it's a random choice.
And it's a random choice, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I guess for me, it's another challenge on learning how to really connect with my audience. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, I could be, you know, I have my own things where I could be like a little reclusive and I just want to be to myself. But if I learned anything dealing with Jamla, the family that we have at Jamla, is that, you know, people is what makes this, you know, this shit work. You know what I'm saying? This is a business of people. You know what I'm saying? The thing, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, you gotta get with people and connect with the people. So, you know, I just saw this as a good way to connect with folks and build some type of community, you know, about the sound that we all create and this craft that we do. So, you know, shout out to DiBiase. He done came to the show. Kid Capri, man, he came in on the second show. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that was
Kid
the crazy shit.
Capri.
Shout out to my man, Afion Crockett, you know what I'm saying? also North Carolina brother, man. He from North Carolina as well. You know, shout out to Soundtrack. He's been on the show. Soundtrack frequents the show. So does DiBiase as well. You know, other Soul Council folks that come in. Shout out to Heather. She's always popping in and out. So, you know, shout out to Illa G. He stuck around for an episode. Yeah, man. It's been fun doing it, man. So, like, just the whole idea of making it a thing. Like, you know, like I said, I had my things where I was, you know, nervous and jittery about it. You know what I'm saying? But it was so in demand that it was just like, it was at a point where it was just like,
it's almost
right,
silly to not do it.
You're
right.
You know what I'm saying? So, right. You know what I'm saying? And shout out to Knife, too, man. He's a, you know, shout out to Knife, shout out to Soundtrack, man, because both of them was very instrumental in the inspiration in me doing this. So,
Yeah. I like that a lot, man. I like a lot of the sort of like creative internet shows that popped up, you know, during like the COVID time. But even though we're kind of past it a little bit,
it's like, post-COVID, but now like internet shows are a thing.
It's a real thing that people will tune in for.
Right. And you know what's really dope? Well, I'm not going to say it's dope, but the silver lining during, I guess, the quarantine era was a lot of people were able to, I guess, find their magic. You know what I'm saying? Or find that part of themselves. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, everybody went into their own thing. You know what I'm saying? Everybody who was able to went into their own thing. I definitely, like, dove into beats. You know what I'm saying? Like, I had a lot. There's a lot of songs that are coming out now that were pandemic beats. You know what I'm saying? We call them, you know, in the producer community, we call them pandemic beats.
Yeah, that's how you have to refer to it.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? You know, Jesus Crisis was definitely a pandemic beat.
You gotta salute me. I'm in red form. I'm back in my devil's reject bag. You gotta rebuke me. You gotta excuse me. I'm the new Jim Jones copper when Louis don't fuck around. Get shot in your coupe.
A lot of the Swank and Drafts project are the pandemic beat. That's a pandemic album, you know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
I finished my album during the pandemic. I don't consider it a pandemic album, but the completion of the album was definitely a pandemic process, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, it's just, yeah.
Cool, yeah. Man, being creative. And, you know, it could get lonely sitting in your room in front of that beat machine
right,
computer, right?
Right.
So to be able to share it, talk about it, ask you questions, you give them insight, it's like, that's a big thing.
Exactly, exactly. Exactly. It, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, that was a good time to connect with audiences, too. You know what I'm saying? During that time, excuse me, I was able to do what I normally do. You know, I noticed the algorithm changed, so I had to switch things up. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So, but back then, I was able to do what I normally do and, you know, was able to touch people like that. So, you know, shout out to the algorithm. It just makes me more creative. Fuck y'all.
Keeping everybody working and thinking harder.
You know what I'm saying? That, yeah. Yo, if anything I learned about making beats, you know what I'm saying? Because, yo, I be jumping around like machines and shit, right? If people, you know, I've been asked before, it's like, why are you going backwards in machine? You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I started on Fruity to get an MP, to mess with an ASR, to get on Reason, to get on to a machine. And then I was like, yo, I want another machine, you know what I'm saying, to get on a 3000 and then, you know, to go back to the ASR and mess around. I got asked one time, yo, there was a point when I was in machine and I wanted to get a 3000, right? And I got asked, like, yo, why do you want to go backwards in technology? You know what I'm saying? And I was like, because I want the limitations. You know what I'm saying? Because I want to figure out all the ways I want to stand in a square and figure out all the ways I could think out in the box in that little itty bitty square. And I want to force myself to be the most, you know what I'm saying? Like, those, like, you got to think, like, hip hop was built on the creativity that people, the level of creativity that people went to when they were forced in a certain box and didn't have,
based off the equipment that they had, yeah, and what they had to work with.
They didn't have instruments. So they went and got, you know what I'm saying? They didn't have a band to play for them, so they went and found one with these records, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you know, it's really the whole idea of taking the little bit that you got and creating something bigger, you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that's my whole concept. That's my whole approach when I'm, you know, jumping in front of a machine or whatever. So, yeah.
Love it. Love
nerd
it.
Shit. Let's go.
Love it, yo. So how did you kind of get your start in making music? You talked about, like, working on FL first. What made you want to start making music? And kind of how long did it take till you were like, yeah, I'm at this level now. This is
out of the front. Well, which level are we talking?
Okay, there's a few different levels.
Yeah.
From when you started making until your first, like, big placement, let's say that. What was your first big placement that you think is big?
All right, so I'll put it this way. I technically made my first beat probably when I was like 12, 13, 14, somewhere in that era. I didn't get my first placement until 2004 when I was, 2004, I was 23. I just ratted my age. Nah, I ain't no little nigga like that. All right, so anyway, I'm 40 as fuck. I was.
You don't got that 40 energy, though.
My first beat was probably back in like 95, somewhere between 95 and 97. And then on some pause tape shit. Mm. You know what I mean? Like, I was doing like pause tape beats when I was like 13, 14. Mm. But I didn't make my first real beat like that. I didn't get Fruity Loops. I got Fruity Loops when I was 18. But then when I met Ninth when I was like 16 or 17. So I met Ninth in like 97. No. I met Ninth in 2000. I met Ninth in 2000. I met Tay in 97, 98. And I met Pooh in 97, 98. When I was still in high school when I met Sean Darn. Mm. First one I met was Sean Darn. I was 16. He introduced me to everybody else. And then, but the way I met them was at North Carolina Central University's radio station, which was the school that Little Brother and a lot of half of the Justice League went to North Carolina Central University, which is also the school that Swank and Draft went to.
Yep, absolutely.
And the other half went to NC State, Wolfpack. All right. So I met the central half of the Justice League. I met Fonte and Pooh and Sean Don when I was like 16. I met Ninth when I was 18. I was using the radio station computer programs that they used to cut commercials with to make beats with.
Wow.
Yeah. So I would go through my dad's record collection when he wasn't looking, record certain shit to tape, take that to the radio studio, and then I would go through the rap vinyl that they had at the radio station and find drums off of those. Mm. I would take a kick here, take a snare from there, take a hi-hat from here, take this open hi-hat from here, take this crash from this other record, and make beats like that. Mm. And then come in and, I would bring in the tape that I got from my pop's records, and you know what I'm saying? And we'd do it like that. The name of the program at the time was called Saw. SAW. It was a dog called Saw.
Interesting.
Right. It's kind of like how Pro Tools, it's like Pro Tools granddaddy or some shit. You know what I'm saying? Mm. Right.
The original.
I mean, I wouldn't say original, but it's like, yeah. Or it was probably like a generic version of Pro Tools. Okay. Since we can mark the first rap album being recorded on Pro Tools in like 96, and we're talking like 97, 98, 99. So, yeah.
A big ass computer.
It was OG PC Windows 97 in this motherfucker. You know what I'm saying?
Compared to today, those things are big.
Yeah.
I mean, you.
They got them little cube looking cable box looking motherfuckers now. So yeah. Smaller than a cable box. Crazy, right?
It's crazy, yeah, man. Technology is amazing.
Yeah.
What I mean, you have a very interesting style. What are some of like your favorite albums that you like to go back and listen to?
Soul Survivor by Pete Rock. Always.
Mm, I love that. I got that on vinyl.
Yeah. Oof. That's like definitely one of my favorite albums ever. What albums do I go back to? Welcome to Detroit. Man, it's always something I'm going back to.
My next question was going to be favorite producer MCs.
Favorite producer MCs?
Like you mentioned Pete Rock already. Dilla. Right there. Dilla.
Mm. Dilla, he was probably the best producer MC to me. That's just me. But then you have
Large Pro is one of my favorites.
Yeah, you got Large Pro, but then you got the RZA. Then you got shit. You got a lot of MCs that produce. Busta, he produces his own.
It's kind of more low key.
Busta makes beats too, but he be on. Oh shit, we're Q-Tip. Fucking Q-Tip.
It's late, y'all. It's late right now.
It's late. I've been smoking. I've been drinking. I've been performing. Q-Tip, he's like the one. Q-Tip is the like the ultimate MC that and producer is Q-Tip. Put together, Q-Tip is the best. Q-Tip is the one. Dilla, all right. Dilla is one thing. Like Dilla is one thing, but the but Q-Tip, like. Yeah,
he's definitely one of my favorites.
He is the producer MC. Like, yeah,
quintessential.
He's the quintessential producer MC.
So we talked a little bit about your inspirations. We just talked about Q-Tip. You produced a few songs on Phife Forever.
Yes,
bruh.
Yes.
Talk about this process. How did that come Phife, about,
man? First of all, rest in peace to Phife.
Yes.
We actually. The Fall Back record, I actually recorded his vocals with him. He came to North Carolina. He's a UNC fan, unfortunately. It's Duke over here. Come on. And that's by default. Come on now.
Y'all should know.
I don't even watch sports, and I'm a Duke fan. But
you're with ninth, no question.
You know what I'm saying? So, but nah, like, so he came to watch a Carolina game, and you know, he stuck around. Which, you know, he's a UNC fan. You know, that was his thing. You know what I'm saying? So, he would come to town often to catch games. And, you know, he stuck around for a few days this round, and, you know, he wanted to come rock with us. So he came by the studio, you know, he rapped. He just came in and hung out with everybody for a little bit. And, you know, when it came time to pick beats, man, you know, that was one of the ones he picked, man. He wrote to it on the spot. And, yeah.
Sounds so beautiful, don't you agree? Yes, sir. Be courtesy of Khrysis. You know what I mean? Come on. This how we do from New Yiddy to the Bull City MC. Yeah. Check it out. White CL 550, ivory interior. Do it all for her, you random chicks are inferior. My starship's superior. Fuck if you ain't feeling her. Better bring on the haters, I'm saying the more the merrier.
We laid it down. I started making plans for the record. But after he passed, because you know I taught one on one of him, but after he passed, his manager Rasta Root reached out to me about it, and I was like, you know what, you can have it, take it, take what you want, take what you want, man. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, he recorded Wild Factor on his own. But then Root, you know, he made the call for Rhapsody and Renee on the Fall Back record, and he sent me back all the vocals, and yeah, we got to mixing on it. My man Give 'Em Soul played keys on it. Bob Power put the final mix on it.
And Bob Power,
shout out to Bob Power.
Hell yeah.
And yeah, man.
That's awesome.
Rasta Root put his magic touch on there, man, and yeah, off to the races.
That's amazing, man. It was really cool to see your name on there.
It was great to be on there, man.
I believe the first time I saw your name on a track was with Mac Miller.
Oh, wow. Which record?
Was it on a Piff Jar mixtape? Did you do something on Piff Jar, maybe?
Yes, you did.
I think that's probably the first one.
Was that one?
Oh yeah, yep, exactly. Right.
Okay, yeah,
exactly.
Right. Okay, yeah.
They think that I'ma lose my mind out here. Ask me where I think I'll be this time next year, but I.
So, I mean, that was a while ago. That was one of the first, that was when I was digging deeper into hip hop. You know, Mac, I would always listen to interviews, which is why I love doing them now. You know, I love insight. So he would give interviews and he would talk about Q-Tip and Big L and these people. So I would go back and do my research. And, you know, that Piff Jar album is during that time. So that was one that I always went back to, you know, first started smoking. So it's just like, yeah, this is the stuff that you chill and want to listen to. So, I mean, shout out to that. Rest in peace to Mac Miller.
Rest in peace.
Crazy.
Yeah.
So you...
really dope MC, man. Just a good soul overall. You know
talk about him. I mean, his last couple albums were... like in a totally different direction than
because that was the artist almost, that he wanted to be from jump in the first place. You know what I'm saying? Like, I saw that part about him. You know what I'm saying? Like, he definitely had a certain soul to him. Yo, I gotta tell y'all our first conversation with him. Like, you gotta mind, like, when I met him, 19-year-old kid, like, you gotta mind you, I'm from black ass Durham, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, first thing he told me when we met face to face was, yo, Khrysis, man, I used to freestyle the Onion Head when I was a kid. That, like, I go home from high school, I would pull that beat up, I would pull the instrument up on YouTube, and Onion Head, that was the beat I used to freestyle to every day. Shout out to, rest in peace to Mac Miller, and rest in peace to Sean Price. But yeah, like, I was just like, word? All right. So, and then, you know, we cut She Said the next day.
She Said, yeah.
Yeah, we cut She Said the next day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
That's amazing, man. One of my favorite artists, for real. For sure. Definitely inspired me. So, you're from North Carolina?
Yes.
And spent time in Jersey? Is that right?
I was born in New Jersey.
Born in Jersey.
Yeah.
Okay.
I moved to North Carolina when I was 4. Now, here's the kicker. You ready? Here's the kicker. I don't talk about this very often. I never talked about this in an interview at all. Here's the kicker. After fifth grade, I spent time in Grand Junction.
Here?
Grand Junction.
Colorado. I see the signs. I'm like, here?
Yeah.
Okay.
I spent time in Grand Junction.
Shit.
And I did West Middle School completely. And I did, like, my first semester of my freshman year of high school, like, Grand Junction High School, and moved back to Durham and graduated from Hillside in 2000.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Box State Connection. That's funny.
Crazy, right?
That's funny.
There it is, people.
So I asked the guys earlier about their favorite pizza spot or food spot. You have any go-to spots? You know, King Draft was representing all Jersey pizzerias real hard. Okay.
North Carolina, Smoking Jerk, he got a food truck that's out there. It's pretty banging. Who else, man? Shit, all our food spots. Yo, all our food spots closed, man. We used to have Dillard's, man. They gone. Shout out to Dillard's. It was right next to my high school on Fairville Street in Durham. It's a gas station. They tore it down and built a gas station on that bitch, man. Fuck BP.
Some good barbecue before.
Oh,
like Prime or something like that.
Prime is good. Prime is good. It's not. I don't know if they're exclusive to North Carolina, you know, but Prime is really good.
Okay.
Shit, it's the chicken and waffle spot. I forgot their name though. It'll come back to me, man. You know what I'm saying? It's a black-owned spot. You know what I'm saying? Durham cats, they know what I'm talking about, man. Chicken and waffles, man. They joints be hitting too, man. They just opened up a new... They opened the spot and carried it. It started in downtown Durham. But it's really good.
We're going to find out. I have to let the people know.
Yeah, I'm going to look it up. I'm going to look it up. And you know what I'm saying? You're just going to have to drop it. Or you're going to have to drop the joint.
Hell yeah.
You're just going to have to drop it. All about
information.
Yeah, just... Put it right here. I forgot your name, but put it right here because I'm going to give him the name and he's going to write it right here.
We got you.
Cool. All right.
Yo, Khrysis, I really appreciate it, man. I really appreciate the time. I mean, I appreciate you taking over sound check and, you know, doing the whole thing. It was cool to watch you work, and I took a lot of notes tonight.
What do you mean I took over sound check? What do you mean, man?
Well, you didn't take over sound check. You were – I didn't know how to direct the guy in the back. Hey, up, down, do this, do
it's,
that.
It's not. It's just, all right.
There's a way to do it, I guess. And I wasn't I've just never him. Experienced that.
All right, look. I wasn't directing him. I was communicating to him.
That's right.
You know, I was always told the sound man is your friend. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, you got to tell him what you want because he can't tell you how you sound, right? Only you can tell him how you sound.
You'll have different perspectives about how it sounds.
It's not even perspective. It's can you hear yourself? That's what I'm looking for. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, if I can't hear myself, if these rappers can't hear themselves on stage, then the whole show's, you know what I'm saying? That's going to have niggas throwing their voice out and shit. That's why, you know, you go to certain shows, niggas be hollering and screaming and yelling and shit. You know what I'm saying? It's because they can't hear themselves. You know what I'm saying? So, you know.
You got the sound right for the show. I'll say that.
I mean.
I'll say that.
What I said earlier. My mixing shit transferred over to other shit.
So, got the ear.
Yeah. So, yeah. It's all connected. You know what I'm saying? It's about how, you know. The people who heard it, they heard. The people who know, they know. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Who heard what I said? I ain't going to keep saying it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
The secret's out now. But there it is. Yeah.
There it is, y'all. Thank you for checking out this video.
For sure.
Khrysis, thank you again.
My man,
I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me, man.
Hey, bro. Good luck on the rest of the tour. Safe travels.
Thank you, man. For sure.
Yeah, lyrical miracle, singing Negro spiritual. We all the way live while you niggas is pitiful. You sure they wanna ride till she reaching the pinnacle. See it all up in the face, ain't no need for subliminal. Moving in silence, all you get is a visual. General be the squad, my nigga, check for the interview. Smart, dumb niggas never keeping it simple, dude. Hoping you get a clue, the fuck you finna do. What? You know we gotta get the green.